So what we have done so far in magnetic materials is that how an atom gets magnetic moment, what are the reasons for that, how to calculate atomic magnetic moment. So that defines paramagnetism of an atom. When it is extended to a solid, it gives rise to paramagnetic susceptibility. And we also saw what happens when it is a molecule. The game is slightly different, as we have seen the contradiction between hydrogen atom and hydrogen molecule versus oxygen atom and oxygen molecule. This we have seen. The effect of or response of the magnetic field that we have been talking about is somewhat different when it comes to a metal. That is what somebody was asking in the morning, which I answered. That is giving rise to different paramagnetism called the Pauli paramagnetism, which I am not able to talk today. Let me see whether I can include in the last lecture. So now we are in a position to see what happens to the magnetism of a solid, the real bulk solid that we know. So basically we are looking at the solid state magnetism. Our journey started with electronic part, went and we built up an atom consisting of electrons, the contribution giving rise to atomic magnetic moment, the Hund's rules giving you the atomic magnetism, atomic magnetic moment. When we went to molecules, where we saw that molecular orbitals, bonding versus antibonding, filling, degeneracy and Pauli's exclusion principle, all these things together determine what kind of magnetism, whether it is going to be paramagnetic, the molecule is going to be paramagnetic or diamagnetic, this we have seen. Now the next obvious thing is to see what happens in the case of solid state bulk magnetism. Here we, as I think mentioned earlier, we have to distinguish between metals and insulators. In this lecture I will only talk about insulators. In the case of metals, the problem is, as we have seen in the morning, you have these bands, you have this free electron kind of picture coming there, and the magnetism, the response of the magnetic field is somewhat different. So let us proceed with what happens in the case of magnetism or the magnetic response of an insulating material like ferrite, for example. So now we are trying to look at, you know, what happens in the case of paramagnetism in the case of an atom. Now the same thing can be extended to a solid insulating. Now onwards, solid means insulating solid. Most of the oxides are actually insulating solids. So in the case of Hund's rule, we found that it is a ground state that we obtained from the rule of J equal to L minus S or L plus S, depending on the situation, less than half fill, more than half fill case, but that was a ground state. Now in reality, we will be interested in finding out at finite temperatures what is the magnetic response for that. So that is what, so this is the ground state that one obtains when you actually have the paramagnetic kind of a situation. When you apply a magnetic field, as we have seen, this ground state J split, this has a degeneracy of 2J plus 1, that is 2J plus 1 different MJ values, all of them have the same energy in the absence of a magnetic field. When you apply a magnetic field, the degeneracy is removed, you have MJ levels, 2J plus 1 such values will be there, and this is what is known as, this is known as a ground state multiplied, because these all levels are actually degenerate in the absence of a magnetic field, and hence this is called the ground state multiplet. So the Hund's rule actually gives you the quantum number corresponding to the ground state multiplet. This multiplet splits under the influence of an applied magnetic field like the one which is shown here. So at finite temperatures, what is going to happen is these levels get occupied, and the magnetization or the susceptibility will be determined by what kind of population, what kind of distribution that we talked in the case of solid state also, what kind of a distribution is going to show, give you the physical property here, which is in this case susceptibility, magnetic susceptibility. To do that, I have just given all the steps, you can go through it, some of the important things I will talk about it. So the general principle is like this, you start with what is known as a partition function, you have studied the partition function is defined like this, e to the power of the energy of a particular level divided by kBT, and this is summed over all the possible levels. In this case, the levels are designated in terms of quantum number mj, the values of which are minus j to plus j. So this summation is nothing but a partition function, And you can make a substitution like this for our mathematical convenience. And once I know the partition function, actually I can calculate many things. So in this case, the most important thing is the average value of Mj, because you have different populations and different Mj levels. So what is the, at a given temperature, equilibrium situation, as we mentioned in the earlier lectures. So what is the average value of Mj, because average value of Mj will give you the average value of the magnetization, and then you can proceed with the calculation of magnetic susceptibility. So Mj, the average value can be calculated like this using this partition function related formula. This actually can be shown that it is 1 by z times dz by dx, where z is a partition function. So I can substitute all these finer details of mathematical steps I am not showing. So if there are n at ions per unit volume, this now is a solid, not just one atom. You take a unit volume, you have n atoms. So this has to be actually multiplied. So this is small n. So this actually gives you the magnetic moment, because the Mj, as you have seen in the case of atom, Mj value will determine what is the magnetic moment. Only other thing is that the G factor and the mu B factor. In this case, n will come, G will come, mu B will come as expected. Instead of a single Mj value, because of the thermal averaging, you have to worry about an expectation value or the average value of Mj. That is what is shown here. So when I substitute, I get this expression, which is not very difficult. All the steps are given here. So little bit of mathematical manipulation, some of these expansions are needed. I will not worry about all these things. You can work out the details. Ultimately, this gives you this magnetization is actually given in terms of a function. This Bjy, this is called a Brillouin function. This Brillouin function has a particular form as shown here. This is a hyperbolic function that is shown here. And the magnetization, the so-called saturation magnetization, M, is given by N times G times J times mu B. J is the maximum value it can take along a particular direction, because when you tell magnetization, it means that you are talking about a particular direction, usually the direction of the quantization direction or the magnetic field direction. So that is what is this one. So this is the magnetization the system is going to have show when you are applying a magnetic field to a magnetic solid of this kind. So Brillouin function has certain properties, that is what is shown here. Once I know the magnetization, I can find out the susceptibility is M by H, or I have been using H and B quite interchangeably. Here there is no problem of confusion with the Hamiltonian, so I will use H in place of B. H stands for the applied magnetic field. So this gives me this expression. This, you can see that J into J plus 1 is coming, which of course came as an eigenvalue for this J square operator. So this is given as N, this is a number of ions per unit volume, number of ions because it is a solid now, mu effective square, this is called a mu effective square, it is a kind of, it is a magnetic moment which actually is defined here. This is given by G times square root of J into J plus 1 mu B. We have been talking about the Z component of the magnetic moment as G times J times mu B, but this is the full moment that once I show, earlier I showed you, this is the length of the full arrow corresponding to the total angular momentum, and now the corresponding magnetic moment, this one. So this is a full magnetic moment which will never get aligned along the applied field direction because of this quantization rule, and this is called the effective magnetic moment. What you actually measure as the component that aligns with respect to the magnetic field, that is the Z component of this one, which of course will be G times, the component of this will be J and this mu B. So the whenever you tell that you are measuring the saturation magnetization, what you are measuring is G times J times mu B, and of course in this case N times, that is a number of ions. So this is one has to keep in mind, this effective magnetic moment is actually defined by this. Now using this, so you can see this particular form, this is N mu effective square divided by 3 kBT, kB is the Boltzmann constant. So here we can see that this has a form chi equal to C by T, where if I define C as this one, so N effective square divided by 3 kVT, I think it should be small n or capital N consistently, there is a mistake, I will correct it. If you take one mole of the substance, naturally the number of ions that will be present will be Avogadro number, so N becomes Na, the Avogadro number, mu effective square divided by 3 kVT. So this is a chi m, and once you can actually plot the, and okay, this is something which happens when you assume that the paramagnetic solid, insulating solid, all these magnetic moments of these different ions, they are not interacting, they are purely isolated, they do not talk to each other, they are completely independent. There is no coupling between them. That is why you are simply summing over without really worrying about any kind of interaction among them. So that is what is given by this one. But in reality, what happens is there will always be an interaction. That is what happens when you take into account that interaction. This, the so-called Curie law, which actually is given by this one, modifies to what is known as a Curie-Weiss law, where it becomes C by T minus theta P. Theta P essentially is having dimensions of temperature, and it kind of gives you a measure of the interaction among the different atomic ionic magnetic moments. So this is a case when there is no interaction. When here we actually make it more realistic, having some, because you have dipoles sitting within a volume, so definitely there will be at least a dipolar interaction, magnetic dipolar interaction. That is what is represented by this theta P having dimensions of temperature. Okay. Now if you see, if you compare the effective magnetic moment, so what we can do is, I think I will just go one step. So okay, what happens if I do a temperature variation of susceptibility measurement? One can see that it will have the 1 by T form, that is what is chi versus T, it will be in this form. If I take 1 over chi versus T, it will be just proportional. And in the ideal Curie situation, when there is no interaction, you will see that this will exactly go through the origin. But if it is not, if there is an interaction, it will actually have an x-intercept. So it will go something like this with a positive intercept here, that is actually showing how much interaction is there among the atomic or ionic magnetic moments. And of course, if you plot chi T versus T, it will be a constant. Now what one can do is that if I plot, for example, this way, from the slope of this, actually I can find out what is a Curie constant C. From the Curie constant, actually I can find out what is my mu effective, because Curie constant essentially is determined by the, other than the constant, it is determined by the mu effective. So such a calculation, one can actually experimentally measure this plot which I showed you, and from that I can experimentally calculate and tell what is the effective magnetic moment. I can also do one thing, I can take the electronic configuration and I can find out what is my L, S, J, assuming that the Hund's rule is correct here, and try to find out what is a J value. Then I find out, substitute the value and see that it is N times G times square root of J into J plus 1 mu B. If I do, I can do a calculation. So that is, I can do a Hund's rule calculation and compare it with an experimentally observed mu effective. Then if I do this for one set of materials, that is the rare earth materials, rare earth based materials which I talked about, that is the one row which is below the periodic table, the so called 4F elements, if I do, what you are getting is something like this. You can see that the Hund's rule calculation, that is what is the square symbols are showing, and the experimental ones. Experimental means I measure chi, the susceptibility, and from that I find out the slope. From that I get Curie constant, from the Curie constant I find out what is the effective magnetic moment. If I do, that is the circle. You can see that very good match in most of the cases, except for one or two cases, very good, excellent match is there between the two. What does it mean? This tells you something. It means that at least in this series of elements, it does not really matter whether you are in an atomic situation or in a solid case, especially in an insulating case. Why is that? This is very important. This is because, as I mentioned sometime, I think the earlier lecture yesterday or day before yesterday, what is happening is these rare earths, the magnetic electrons, which are the 4F electrons, the unpaired electrons are all in the 4F shell, which are very much inside. They are not in a talking term with the other ionic environments. So what happens is they are kind of independent. They are able to retain the atomic character the way it happens in an isolated atom. So if you take different ionic moments, even though they are part of a solid, yes, if it is in the rare earth insulating materials, it is more or less identical to what happens in the case of a single isolated rare earth atom or ion. So the atomic character is more or less retained even when it has formed a solid in the case of rare earth compounds. That is what is shown by this excellent agreement between the Hund's rule calculation and the experimental determination. Remember, I always told that Hund's rule should be used only in the case of atomic magnetism. When it comes a solid, you should not use. But here you see that that statement has to be modified at least in this particular series of elements. The reason why I still insist on telling that Hund's rule must be used only in the case of atoms, you will see very soon. So, in general, better not to use the Hund's rule as the tool to calculate the magnetic effective magnetic moment of a solid. It will give you problem in general. In this case, being a very, very special case, you do not see that. So, some of the values are shown here, the molar susceptibility values are shown here, diamagnets and paramagnets, as I showed you, the values are very small. Okay. Now, so this is what is shown in the earlier plot, the match between the theory and experiment being very good, the same thing is shown here. So, what is shown here is L value, S value, J value, the Hund's rule calculation, and the experiment and theory, you can see that very good match between the two. So, this column and this column, the agreement is excellent in the case of the so called rare earth elements, rare earth compounds, solid compounds, insulating rare earth compounds. The interesting point is the other series which is magnetically important from the periodic table is the transition metal series, where iron, cobalt, nickel, those things are there. I can have compounds, insulating compounds, solids, using these elements, like for example ferrite. Fe2O3 is an example of that. MnO is an example of that. It is an insulating compound. It is made up of, or the magnetic element in that case is transition metal, not the rare earth. What is happening is, I have written all the details here, but I will talk about this. So, same thing if I do, you can see that the experimental moments are shown here. The Hund's rule calculated moments are shown here. You can actually see that, so this is the Hund's rule calculated value, this is experimental value, you can see that there is a big difference. In most of the cases, there is a big difference. For example, you see here, it is 0.77, with the experimental it is 3.88. So, this is a Hund's rule J value. Using the Hund's rule J value, I am comparing with the experimental value, there is a big problem. So, it is unlike the earlier case where agreement was excellent when I calculated the J and found the comparison between experiment and theory. Here it is exactly different. On the other hand, interestingly, if I don't worry about the orbital, if I take that L to be 0 everywhere, if the orbital angular momentum or the orbital magnetic moment contribution is completely killed, if I assume that way, if I simply take as S, in which case my G factor must be 2, because pure spin case G factor is 2, as we have seen. So, if I do that, the calculation will give me this thing. So, instead of J times J into J plus 1, I will use 2 times square root of S into S plus 1, J becomes S. So, if I do that, I will get the last column. And you see the comparison between the last column and the last but one column, 1.70, 1.73, 3.85, 3.87. You see the comparison, 0.77 was far away from 3.85, whereas when I do not take the orbital into account, it is actually 3.87, very, very close to 3.85, which is experimentally observed. So, you can see in all these elements, what is happening is the system is behaving as if it is not able to contribute to the magnetism from the orbital part. That means orbital angular momentum is somehow disappearing. That because of that, orbital magnetic moment is also not able to contribute to the total magnetic moment of the solid. It's a big, big difference compared to atoms, big, big difference compared to rare earth compounds, insulating compounds. So, that is why I was making this statement earlier, the Hund's rule, using this Hund's rule to calculate or talk about or compare the susceptibilities, Curie constant and effective magnetic moments can in general go wrong. And that is what you are seeing in this example. In the case of rare earth, somehow it is working, somehow I will tell you, but in the case of transition metal, it is completely collapsing. Now, before we try to see what is the difference between the two, why this happens, the disagreement is there in this case and the disagreement is not there in the rare earth case, you can see what happens, what is the electronic structure, what happens to the magnet, the so called magnetic electrons in these two series of compounds. As I mentioned just now, in the case of rare earth materials, the magnetic electrons are the 4F electrons, 4F electrons, which are very much inside the shell. On the other hand, in the case of transition metal, the magnetic electrons are the 3D electrons in this series. They are much more exposed than the 4F electrons, and this is the only thing that one can think at the moment. So the difference between the 4F series and the 3D series, which of course is very important, that as we are seeing in the disagreement versus agreement, one should immediately think about the difference in the electronic part, electronic configuration wise. The difference is this one. One is it is, and remember, as it is more and more close inside core, that means the atomic character is going to be predominant. Once you are moving away from the nucleus, as you are going out and out, that means 3D is an outer case, which means that atomic character is not expected to be correct. That is what is seen here. So when the atomic character is not there, you can't use J as your quantum number. It is actually contributed only by S and not by L. Further, so okay, so this, what does it mean? It means that when you have transition metals, whether you have a situation the number wise, whether your total L is becoming 0 or not, if it is a transition metal, irrespective of the number of 3D electrons, you are going to have L equal to 0. Somehow L is made to be 0, so that it is a pure spin magnetism that is coming into picture. That is why when you take J, it does not happen, it does not agree. But if you take purely S alone, you are able to get a good agreement between the theory and experiment. This is called the quenching of orbital angular momentum or the quenching of orbital magnetic moment. So it is a pure spin case that you are seeing in the case of transitional metal compounds, especially in insulators. This does not happen in the case of rare earth compounds. As we have seen, J was working all right. So this is a very important difference compared to the transition metal, between the transition metals and the rare earth compounds, both insulating as I mentioned. So having said this, so now we have some idea about two different classes of paramagnetic solids, all are insulators. One is rare earth based, one is transition metal based, and there is a difference between the two. In one case, there is a problem of quenching of orbital angular momentum, in one case it is not. In the rare earth case, there is no such quenching. Now let us go and go to the next thing, which is more applied, more important, more useful materials, the ferromagnetism. How do you see that? As I mentioned earlier, a ferromagnetic material can be kind of thought about in the form of paramagnets being building blocks. Using those paramagnetic entities, you can create ferromagnetism. And the characterizing features of ferromagnetism are this. They are all very important. They are somewhat connected also. First of all, they have what is known as a spontaneous magnetization. Spontaneous magnetization means in the absence of a magnetic field also, unlike a paramagnet does not show any magnetism unless you apply a magnetic field. But here, ideally you are supposed to get a spontaneous magnetization, that means magnetization in the absence of a magnet, applied magnetic field. They have what is known as a Curie temperature, below which the material is ferromagnetic and above which it is paramagnetic. It is supposed to have, so somebody must be there internally so that the spontaneous magnetization can be explained. That somebody is nothing but what you call, initially people started calling as an internal field. Later people started calling it as a molecular field. Finally, now we know that it is nothing but what is known as an exchange field. I talk about it later. So that is something which is characterizing a ferromagnet. Then you have to see what is an exchange interaction. Ferromagnets are known to have magnetic anisotropy. Anisotropy means it has direction dependent properties. They have domains which actually tell you that even though you talk about spontaneous magnetization as a first point, in reality you do not see the spontaneous magnetization because they have domains which actually does not, they do not allow the spontaneous magnetization to be seen in a bulk scale. And the most important property of ferromagnets, namely the hysteresis, is the last point. All these properties are some way or other connected and they all characterize a ferromagnetic material. This is a usual plot of M versus T. And this is a TC where the magnetization essentially changes abruptly, and here it is ferromagnetic, here it is paramagnetic. So what is shown here is magnetization, and remember, usually a ferromagnetic state is characterized in terms of magnetization, not the susceptibility. Susceptibility is something which is used essentially to characterize paramagnets. As long as the material is in the ordered region, the best thing to talk about, best parameter to talk about is the magnetization, which is a magnetic moment per unit volume as you defined earlier, that is what is shown here. Now let us quickly go and see what happens. Why is this particular set of materials, the so called ferromagnets, have the so called internal field or the molecular field. What people thought in the beginning is that, okay, you have this the magnetic dipoles, as in the case of paramagnets. Only thing is that they are close by. Maybe now they have that magnetic dipole-dipole interaction which actually aligns them. That is a usual thing that you would have studied in electromagnetism also. When you put two dipoles, there is an interaction, the minimization of energy will actually align them to be in the same direction. So people thought that must be the dipole-dipole interaction that must be responsible for getting this kind of an order, that is a so-called ferromagnetic order, which is essentially represented by the value or the strength of this Curie temperature TC. The higher the Curie temperature, the ferromagnetic strength is larger. So people try to explain the TC values in terms of this interaction, that so-called magnetic dipole-dipole interaction. And it was found that you cannot explain TCs of the order of 1000 Kelvin for Fe, and it has a TC of something like 1050 Kelvin, which is very large, above the room temperature. That is why it is room temperature ferromagnetic. So people realize that this kind of an interaction is completely not, one cannot use this interaction to account for the TC of these ferromagnets. So this is completely ruled out. This is a very, very weak interaction which at the most can give you 1 Kelvin TC, nothing more than that. And we are talking about 1000 Kelvin. Remember, this is a magnetic interaction. What really is responsible for this large TC values or the strong ferromagnetic interactions in solids is what is known as exchange interaction, is very important. I will not really go into a solid to explain this. This is again quantum mechanics which you have been talking about in various forms. Let us take the simple example of hydrogen molecule which can be extended to solids. Hydrogen molecule is this, so you have a hydrogen atom here, another hydrogen atom. This is one nucleus, this is the corresponding electron. Similarly, for the next hydrogen atom you have this one. You can take this whole system and write down, forgetting about the nuclear part, I can write down the two electron system, consider this as a two electron system, I can write down the total wave function, which actually consists of the spatial coordinates, that is r1, r2, and the spin coordinates, as I told you yesterday, it is s1 and s2. You can write this in the form of purely orbital part, that is here, and the purely spin part. This is a spin wave function, this is an orbital wave function. And remember, they are electrons are fermions. When you exchange two fermions, the property that is very, very important from quantum statistics is that the wave function should change the sign. So when you change R1 to R2 to R2 to R1, the wave, the total wave function sign should change. This psi, remember, this is capital psi, this is small psi. The total psi should change its sign when I flip between the two. And remember, these two electrons are indistinguishable because it is a quantum system. So this is something which is very important. So the total wave function must be anti-symmetric, that is what is meant by the sign change. Anti-symmetric, this has to be guaranteed. So this can happen in two ways, because you have a product. You can, it can happen in such a manner that suppose this is not changing the sign when you change R1 to R2, that is fine, but then this has to change sign. You have to have a plus minus combination or a minus plus combination so that the net result is minus. So what happens? One can actually write down, I can write down the spatial part of the wave function using the single electron wave functions, that is IA1, that is first electron associated with the first nucleus, second one associated with the second one, and I can make a anti-symmetric combination, that means I am putting a minus sign here. And I take this R1 and R2 are swapped. So what does it mean physically? It means that your R1 and R2, these two electrons, since they are quantum particles, you cannot tell that this is R1 or this is R2. They are not distinguishable, they are identical as we saw yesterday. So if you are telling that at some instant R1, that first electron is with the nucleus A, you cannot rule out that the first electron is sometime with the nucleus B. So that is what is represented by psi A1, psi B R2 and the reverse one here, the ulta one here. And when you are putting a minus sign here, this makes the total wave function anti-symmetric, because if you change, you are changing the sign of the wave function. When this is anti-symmetric, the corresponding spin part must be symmetric. A symmetric spin wave function corresponds to what is known as a triplet. A triplet actually corresponds to a magnetic case. In this case, it is just 2 electrons, but once you bring in magnetism, that corresponds to a magnetic state. On the other hand, I can actually do the same thing with a plus sign, which means that this, when you flip between R1 and R2 between A and B, the sign of the wave function is not changing, the total wave function is not, the sign of the orbital part is not changing. In that case, definitely the spin part has to change in sign. In such a case, it is called a singlet. The singlet means it is non-magnetic. So you can see, in this case is triplet, in this case is singlet. Now what happens is, you have 2 electrons, you have some separation between the 2. In the normal case, when you have 2 electrons, classically speaking, if you want to find out what is the interaction between the 2, the electrostatic interaction between the 2, because I am not interested in the magnetic interaction now, but I am interested in the electrostatic interaction between the 2, the electrostatic repulsion between the 2, the classical Coulomb interaction. If I do, I have to find out what is the E square divided by R12. R12 is a separation between the 2 electrons, so I have to calculate E square by R12. That is a Coulomb repulsion. In quantum mechanics, if I want to do that, I am in the quantum mechanical regime, I have to calculate the expectation value for that term, which is E square by R12. So I have to find out E square by R12 for this state and for this state. When I calculate, that is a very important point, when I calculate the expectation value of E square by R12, which actually happens to be, as we did earlier, it happens to be the energy shift due to the perturbation calculation. As I told you, the first order correction is simply the expectation value of that extra term. The extra term right now is E square by R12 term. So when I calculate for these 2 terms, I see that it is different, and this difference gets reflected between the 2 here. So if I straight away, if I go and already these steps are written here, if I have S1 and S2 are half each, you can have 2 situations. When they are symmetrically combining, that gives rise to your S equal to 1, that is a triplet state, because I can have values of MS 1, 0, minus 1, that is my, it is triplet 3, and if it is 0, it gives you only the singlet. So the energy, electrostatic energy for this state and electrostatic energy for this state is different. This is not what is expected in classical electromagnetism. So when I can actually calculate and show what happens, but better to show this picture. So when there is no electrostatic interaction between the 2 electrons, you have some energy, the separate energy added together, hydrogen atom 1, hydrogen atom 2, take the energies, add them together. That is what is represented by this horizontal line. Now if you bring in the usual classical electrostatic interaction without really worrying about wave function and things like that, I have this charge, I have this charge E and E, E square by R12, R12 is a separation between the 2, I get a normal Coulomb term, E square by R12 term, which is positive, is repulsive, so energy increases. So that is why this is at a higher level. Now if I do the same thing quantum mechanically, which is a requirement at this point of time, because of the difference between the 2 states, what is found is, when I take the triplet state, the energy is going to be slightly smaller compared to this one. So that means in this case, when my J is called the exchange term, this J, as long as J is positive, what you are seeing is, you are having a preference of triplet state over the singlet state. And remember, singlet is non-magnetic, triplet is magnetic. So what you are seeing is an interaction which you have completely forgotten earlier. So quantum mechanical analog of electrostatic interaction is responsible to stabilize a triplet state over a singlet state. A triplet state in general is nothing but a magnetic state. So in this case, you are seeing an example where your magnetic state is stabilized compared to a non-magnetic state because of an electrostatic interaction. It's not magnetic interaction, it's very, very important point. Remember, I started with a magnetic dipole-dipole interaction, which is a purely magnetic interaction. It has no role in determining what kind of a magnetic order at a high temperature situation is going to happen. On the other hand, the real issue, the real reason why you are getting a magnetic state stabilized over a non-magnetic state, that is a triplet state is stabilized with respect to a singlet state in the case of a simple example like hydrogen molecule, is the electrostatic interaction quantum mechanically. This quantum mechanical electrostatic interaction, or it is a spin dependent electrostatic interaction or a spin dependent Coulomb interaction, this is a spin dependent Coulomb interaction, that is what is stabilizing magnetism here over the non-magnetic state. this kind of a thing can be expected for a solid also. Only thing is that you have to expand little more, not just 2 electrons, 2 atoms. You have to expand it in a much, much larger number of neighbors and so on. So, this idea is very important. So, the first thing is electrostatic interaction, spin dependent electrostatic interaction is responsible for the ferromagnetism. On the other hand, in a general sense, if my J is negative, one can show that anti-ferromagnetism will be lower energy state compared to a ferromagnetic state. So, the ground state will be determined by the sign of your exchange term J. Actually, it is the exchange integral, I will not go into the details, it is essentially the exchange term J. So, this is a usual Coulomb term which is there for both the states equally, that is why it is equally displacing the energy to the positive side. But then there is a positive shift or a negative shift depending on the spin state, the total spin, not the spin state in the sense that the total spin, triplet has lower energy, singlet has higher energy. So, this is a preference of magnetic state over the non-magnetic state. This is nothing but ferromagnetism if you expand for a solid. So, that is what is shown here. So, when you have S equal to 1, you have 3 possibilities, they are all symmetric possibilities, and when S is equal to 0, you have only M S equal to 0, that is an anti-symmetric possibility, triplet versus singlet. See the hydrogen molecule which we talked about earlier, it is a diamagnetic material, hydrogen molecule, unlike hydrogen atom. The reason is for a strong bonding, hydrogen atom is a very strongly bonded molecule. When you want a strong bonding, you need to have the wave functions to be in such a manner that they are bonding. You needed a bonded orbital. When it is bonded, it is a symmetrically orbital, it must be symmetric, which means that your spin wise it must be anti-symmetric. Anti-symmetric means it is a singlet state, that means it is something like this. A bond, well bonded situation demands a singlet state, that is why this is non-magnetic. Hydrogen molecule is non-magnetic. So, this idea can be extended for solids without much of a difficulty. So, very important point is the first thing, first characterizing property of a ferromagnet, namely spontaneous magnetization, which can be explained by the molecular field, which can be called the exchange due to the exchange interaction, is mainly, it is really because of the electrostatic contribution. Spin dependent electrostatic contribution is responsible for this thing. It is somewhat unexpected because one would have expected a magnetic contribution to give rise to this one, that is not the case. So, electrostatic interactions play a big role in determining ferromagnetism. It is a very, very kind of surprising information. Another surprising information comes again. Other very important property, as I mentioned, is magnetic anisotropy. What is magnetic anisotropy? Direction dependence, as I mentioned. If I take a crystal, magnetize, apply the magnetic field along different crystallographic directions, as you would have seen in the crystallographic topics. For example, in the case of Fe, it is much easier to magnetize along 100 direction, as you can see the saturation is very fast, whereas 111, it is difficult. Why is it happening? So, the same material, the crystal is behaving differently for different directions. You need very high magnetic field for certain directions, or magnetism wise certain axes are acting as if they are very soft and certain other axes are hard, or this in this case 100 direction is called an easy axis of magnetization compared to 111, which is actually a hard axis of magnetization. So, this is easy axis, this is hard axis, there is a difference between the two. One can actually write down the energy, so there is a built-in anisotropy energy, the energy required to magnetize along different directions. This can be written in terms of these constants, as I have written here. For a cubic crystal, you can see that one can write in this form, where alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 are nothing but the direction cosines of this magnetization vector with respect to the axis ABC. In the cubic case, A, B, C are all the same, but they are mutually perpendicular. So, this direction cosines, of course, the square of the direction cosines sum is 0, 1. So, it becomes this first term is this one, second term is given by this, third term is given by this. So, this tells you if you depending on the direction of the magnetization, you can have different energies, that is what is represented by this. So, basically it tells you that different directions if you try to magnetize, you need to do different amounts of work or the magnetic field needed to saturate will be different depending on the direction, as you have seen in the figure. For a hexagonal system, the same thing can be talked about. Here again, we write the expression for the so called anisotropy energy for different directions. the direction in this case is easier because here you have a unique axis. What is a unique axis? In these systems, the so called uniaxial crystal systems like hexagonal, tetragonal systems, you have a C axis which is different from the AB plane. So, the magnetization is always written with respect to that C axis, the angle is taken as theta. So, you write the energy in terms of this theta either in the form of sin square theta and sin to the power of 4 theta. One can find out which is easy axis and which is hard axis by the minimization of the energy in this case. That is what is written here. What are the, it's again very important, what are the reasons why they for this direction dependence? What is the problem? So, this again gives you some very important physics of these materials. There are two reasons for this. Remember, we are talking about a solid, we are talking about a ferromagnetic insulating solid like the ferrite material, that is a very common example that always people can give. So, what is happening? The two reasons are there, I start to give the answer and then explain. One is what is known as a crystalline electric field. Second is a spin orbit coupling. So, the dependence of magnetic anisotropy is very strong on the hexagonal and tetragonal systems compared to the cubic systems. I will come to that. So, first let us worry about the two main reasons for that. One is a crystalline electric field, second is spin orbit coupling. What is the meaning of this? Remember, I am talking about ferrite. Let us for some time let us take ferrite as an example, Fe2O3. I am taking the Fe2O3 example till I finish this section. It is an insulator, one can think like a ferromagnet, does not matter whether it is exactly ferromagnet or not, but the idea is going to work. What is going to happen is you have a d electron there, all the d electrons are there, that is why you have a paramagnetism, it is interacting, exchange is there, it is becoming ordered. What is going to happen is you have these d electrons. We have the wave functions corresponding to d electrons. There is an orbital degeneracy of 5, there is a spin degeneracy of 2, total degeneracy of 10. That is why we tell that it can take a maximum 10 electrons. D shells can take 10 electrons maximum. This is an isolated case, isolated atom case. Now, such an atom is actually surrounded by oxygen neighbors. In this case, oxygen is a neighbor. Oxygen is positive. Or positively charged because it is an ion, it is a solid, ionic solid in some sense. So you have positive charges surrounding this atom which is magnetic. So, you can expect an electrostatic interaction or electrostatic field produced by this negative ions of oxygen. Oxygen is negative. Negative ions of oxygen which are the neighbors will produce an electrostatic field. What is going to happen because of this electrostatic field? What is shown here, first let us see what happens here. In the absence of these neighbors, this negative oxygen ions, what is going to happen is that you have a 5-fold orbital degeneracy, that is what is shown here. All of them have degeneracy of 5. Now, if you are actually having the electrostatic interaction, you will see that because of this electrostatic interaction, one can actually apply a perturbation here, I will not go into the details. This degeneracy is partially removed and you will see that you have a 3-fold degeneracy which is pushed down and a 2-fold degeneracy which is up. If you have a slightly different symmetry, you can get exactly ulta, you have a doublet here and a triplet here. And you see this is atomic situation where you are talking about this one or this one is an atomic situation where your Hund's rule is fine. But now your energy scheme for the d electrons is not what was as in the case of an atom. It is quite different now because of the presence of these neighbors which are negative ions, oxygen negative ions. So, the energy level scheme to deal with now is not this but this. And our Hund's rule definition, Hund's rule calculation, Hund's rule description, everything was with respect to this. So, naturally it is going to fail. That is why you have seen one of the reasons why there was a discrepancy between the calculation of effective magnetic moment for the 3D case as the table suggested. This is not a case in the case of rare earth compounds as we have seen. So, the 3D case, this interaction is going to be strong. Why? Because your 3D shell is more exposed compared to the 4F shell and this electrostatic charges which are there on these oxygen ions, this is going to create this electrostatic field. and this electrostatic field is acting as a perturbation and it is going to change the energy level scheme from this situation to this situation in the case of one symmetry, in a different symmetry is this one. In either case, this is not good, this is not correct. This is a very, very important difference compared to an isolated transition metal atom and a transition metal compound insulating. So, what is the real situation? So, what really happens is, I will first show you the familiar picture that you all have seen. You would have seen similar pictures like this. So, this is called a dxy orbital, dyz orbital and things like that. These orbitals are the one which actually are used in molecules or in solids. These molecules, these charge clouds have certain direction dependence. These direction dependence, and when these direction dependences are there and you have an electrostatic interaction coming from the negative ions of oxygen, certain directions get preferred over the others because of this particular nature of charge clouds, because these are all charges, right, negative charges. So, if there is a corresponding electrostatic interaction, naturally certain directions will be preferred over the other. That is what is actually shown quantum mechanically here. I will not go into all the details of this one. So, basically your wave functions, when you are in a solid which is having an interaction of this kind, the wave functions of these d electrons must be modified and they must be not in the usual form of psi nlm like 3, 2, 2. It should be the linear combinations of this kind which give rise to the probability densities or the charge densities as shown this one. Again, you have to get 5, 5 orbital states are there, so you should get 5 after the linear combinations also. But this linear combination business becomes an important thing because of this presence of this perturbation, which is an electrostatic perturbation because of the oxygen neighbors. Again, you see the role of electrostatic interaction is becoming very, very important in determining the magnetism. Like the exchange interaction is purely an electrostatic interaction, we do not expect it. But again here you see another electrostatic interaction which is responsible for creating the stabilization of certain energy directions over others. So, what happens now? So, because of this direction dependence, it is not isotropic, it is direction dependent, and hence depending on the situation of the electrostatic sign, one can show that certain things are preferred over the other, the energies are changing, certain things are stabilized over the others, that is why something is pushed down, something is pushed upside. And not only that, the degeneracy, 5-fold degeneracy has been removed, and as I showed you 3 versus 2 or 2 versus 3, not only that, now if you see this linear combination combined wave functions shown here in the form of dxy or dyz or dxx for that matter, they are all real functions. You see there is an I here, so because of this, they are all real functions. Unlike our psi nlm functions of hydrogen atom, they are all complex. There is an e to the power of IML5 functions that will make it complex. Now, that thing is not there, they are all real functions, that is what is plotted here. All these things are real functions, there is nothing complex here, there is nothing imaginary here. What is the immediate effect of this? The immediate effect of this is what is shown here. I want to find out in magnetism context, I am always interested in finding out what is the expectation value of angular momentum, because I know that that is what is related to the magnetic moment, corresponding orbital magnetic moment. So, I want to find out what is the expectation value. Before I calculate, in like one of the tutorial problems which I did, before I calculate this, I can find out what is going to be the value. What is the expectation value of LZ? I have to find out. I can actually, I can take the form of these wave functions. It is typically of the form XFR, YFR and ZFR. These are the wave function form, the p orbitals. But what is going to happen? They are all real. And what is my operator? My operator has an I. Operator is imaginary, and remember any result of a quantum mechanical measurement must be real. Expectation values and eigenvalues must be real. I am calculating the expectation value of LZ. LZ is the Z component of orbital angular momentum. Since my orbital part, the wave function part is completely real and I am having an imaginary operator here, I cannot get anything other than 0. So, my orbital angular momentum is going to be 0 in this case, and hence the orbital angular momentum is said to be quenched, and hence the magnetic corresponding magnetic moment also is quenched. That is why I am forced to put J equal to S when I deal with transition metal compounds, as we have seen in that table. So what really happens here, what is unexpected, that is what is happening here. If you are doing the same thing for an atom, which of course I did, there your wave functions are not real, and hence there is no question of this becoming 0, unless it is an L equal to 0 state, that is a very special case. But in general, it doesn't become 0. But now if you see, this is actually becoming 0. It has to be 0 provided the orbitals are real, and that is what is actually demanded by the presence of this perturbation, namely the electrostatic interaction. So this is a very, very important aspect of this one. This explains the two things: this effect of this crystal field, the so-called crystal field, the electrostatic field produced by the oxygen negative ions in this example. This is the called crystalline electric field. Crystalline means because they are all arranged in particular positions in the solid. It is an electrostatic field, hence it is called the crystalline electric field. This has two things. One is it gives rise to the direction dependence of the magnetic moment. Second is, at least first order, it actually shows you that it cannot have any orbital contribution to the magnetic moment or angular momentum. So what does it tell? So this direction dependence comes into picture, and now because of this spin orbit coupling, that is the second term, whatever orbital contribution it has got, the spin orbit coupling, the spin also will be forced to follow the orbital and gives rise to the certain specific preferences of directions over the others, which will tell you that in the, as in the case of other FE example, 100 is preferred over 111. So the direction dependence is purely due to electrostatic interaction produced by the ions which are surrounding this particular magnetic ion. The effect of this one can see very interestingly here. So you can see this is a 5-fold degeneracy because of the crystal field. The splitting has happened with 3 versus 2. What you can see here is that you can have various situations. If I try to put it here, if I have 5 electrons, for example, if I take Fe3+, I have to accommodate 5 electrons in the 3D shell. There are possibilities. One possibility is that I put, they are anyway degenerate, I can, there is that orbital degeneracy of 3, I can put 3 up spins, no problem, no violation of Pauli's principle. I put 3 here. Remaining 2, I have 2 possibilities. I can put either here. So if I am ready to expend some energy, so I can go here higher level and put it here. Or if I want to put it in the lower level only, then I cannot make them up spins, I have to make them down spins only. So this, if it has to be here, these next 2, the last 2 will be down spins, which means that this will kill the 2 up spins. So essentially the magnetism will be reduced. So that is why it is called a low spin configuration, whereas here if you see, these 3 are up, these 3 are up, that is giving rise to a high spin case. If it is an atom, it is a pure atom, these things are not really true. I just have a 5-fold degeneracy, and as we have seen the 5 boxes, I can put, it is a half filled situation, I can put all the 5 up. So again something like this, but the energy is going to be different. But you can see this is a high spin case, this is a low spin case. This is purely because of the electrostatic interaction, namely the crystal field that we talked about. Now, what is the next thing is domains. Many of you know about it. Domains are needed to explain the fact that you have no magnetization in the bulk scale even for a ferromagnet. The reason, I will straight away go to the reason since we are running out of time. What happens is, if I take a ferromagnet and if I assume that everything is one domain, the magnetization has to be spontaneously there, and the magnetization will be something like this. This is not a stable system. Energy wise, this is not a stable system. It will prefer to be something like this, just to give an example. The reason for this is, this has got what is known as a very large magnetostatic energy. The system does not want to have large magnetostatic energy. System tries to reduce the magnetostatic energy. That is done by splitting into multiple domains. That is what is shown here. But in that process, what you have to get, these lines are nothing but the domain walls. These domain walls will give you a slight increase in energy. That is why, if you, okay, I am telling that this is not favorable, this is favorable, then the immediate question is, can you have infinite number of domain walls? I can't do that because I want to reduce the magnetostatic energy. For that, I am constructing these walls and separating them out. But remember, like what I am making a cabin here, if I want to get 2 cabins, I have to make a wall. construction of a wall costs some energy. So, if I, even though I am gaining something, if I am increasing energy in that process, it will not survive after some time. Similarly, here, if you are trying to make more and more domains to reduce the magnetostatic energy, beyond a point, the domain walls that you are forced to create will have some energy associated with it. It will try to increase energy, and finally, you will see that there is no energy gain and the process will stop there, so that you always end up with a finite number of domains. So, this is the calculation of the so called magnetostatic energy, or it is also called the demagnetizing energy. The demagnetizing energy, I have a very simple example here to show. So, what happens is that when you take a magnet, you magnetize it, it has got a south pole and a north pole. The lines of force as shown here, something like this. If you see here, so this is a magnet material you have taken, you magnetize with the help of a magnetic field and the field has been removed. Assume that you got north pole here, south pole here. So, the lines of force are coming like this. Now, inside the material, the lines of force are something like this. Now, you remember your original magnetic field has been applied like this, so that you got this. Now, because the poles have developed like this, there is an internal field that is happening, the so called demagnetizing field, which is in this direction HD, which is opposite to the applied field, which actually caused this magnetization. So, when you magnetize any object, any ferromagnet, when you make it, what is going to happen is the process itself, the very process itself actually creates a field which actually is going to be opposite to the original field. This is true only within the material. So, within the material, it is subjected to a reverse field. So, the system is always like that. When you are trying to magnetize it, you are always leaving the system with a demagnetizing field. As long as you have poles, and as long as you have poles only, you will tell that it is magnetized. So, the system will always have a demagnetizing field the moment it is born. The enemy is always born along with its birth. The moment it is born, the enemy is also born. You cannot separate them out. The demagnetizing field is an enemy which will be born along with the magnet itself. Here the magnet means anything that is magnetized. So, whenever you are telling that I am trying to magnetize something, that means you are actually trying to overcome the demagnetizing field. So, the demagnetizing field is essentially proportional to the magnetization with a minus sign. So, this proportionality constant is called the demagnetizing factor. So, that is minus nd times m. At any instant, if the magnetization is m prime, let me call it as the demagnetizing field at that instant of time will be minus md times m prime. Now, if you want to increase the magnetization little more by dm, I have to do a work, that work is given by this against this one, so the minus becomes plus. So, when I am telling that I have a material which is magnetized to a value m, which means that I have done a work which is actually the integral of this, which is nothing but half ndm square. This is the magnetostatic energy, which actually can be also called as the demagnetizing energy, which is a thing which actually is an unstable thing. Only way this can be reduced to 0 or minimized is to reduce the magnetization. So, that is why any magnet when it is made to have some magnetization m, the tendency is always to reduce the magnetization. That is why people tell whenever you are using bar magnets, handle it very carefully. Assume that you are not doing any temperature, increasing temperature, nothing happens, but still there is an unstable situation there. The system has an intrinsic tendency to reduce this m, that is to make the energy less. Which energy less? The magnetostatic energy less. So, this is a very important aspect of this any magnet that you have. This I already explained. So, creation of domain walls will create increase energy. So, beyond a point, this will not be entertained. Because of this demagnetizing part, when the poles are there, when you have free poles, this is always creating these demagnetizing fields. So, when you have a thin film, you have a thin film, generally what happens is we are trying to magnetize it. It is much easier to magnetize like this, because if you are in this direction, the poles will be coming here. These poles are far separated and the effect of demagnetizing field is very small. Compared to the situation when you are magnetizing like this, when the poles are separated by a very small distance, typically a few angstrom or something like a few microns. So when these poles are so close by, the effect of demagnetizing field within the material, demagnetizing field is only within the material, is very strong. That means it is very difficult to magnetize like this. You need extremely much larger fields to have the magnetization like this compared to this one. So in thin films, usually magnetization like this is easier compared to this one, unless there are some other effects. When, for example, you have a magnetocrystalline anisotropy which is very strong, then this is okay. But in usual cases, this is something which is usually preferred. This is a direct immediate effect of demagnetizing fields. I am coming to the end, let me. So when you apply a magnetic field, what is really happening is you are having a multi-domain structure giving no magnetization in the beginning, zero. As you increase the magnetic field, the domains, actually the domain which has got the magnetic intrinsic magnetization in the same direction as applied field, that grows in size with the help of these domain walls movement, and ultimately you see that the material becomes single domain, that is what is corresponding to the saturation. The magnetization of a ferromagnet always saturates at some high field, that is what you see here. This again is very important. As I mentioned, this is a hysteresis when I actually make a complete field cycle. It starts with a very magnetization, increases, it saturates, and then when you reduce this one, as I was mentioning just now, the domain wall motion, which is responsible for the change in the magnetization as a function of the magnetic field increase or decrease or reversal, this is going to be an irreversible process because of various factors which are that are present in the material. I will not be able to go to the details. It can be intrinsic defects, artificially created defects, many other situations. This will make the magnetization reversal or the domain wall motion kind of irreversible, giving rise to this hysteresis loss, which is a loss which actually appears as heat in the material. So if you cycle it, after some time you see that the magnet gets heated. It is not a good thing for many applications, but for certain applications like permanent magnets, you need to store energy, it has to give the field, you need to get large remanence, that means the magnetization at the end of the zero, that is after reducing the magnetization, the first magnetization cycle, you want the material to have the maximum magnetization. Of course, it is unstable, that is true, but you need to have that. Or similarly, you need to have a very large coercivity, that is a field required to kill the magnetization completely. So these two things should be as large as possible in the case of permanent magnets, the bar magnets that we use for many of our experiments. But applications where you are actually forced to cycle the thing, like for example a transformer where the field is cycling every 50 times every second, the 50 hertz frequency of the line we have there, this should not be the case. It should be very thin so that the energy losses are minimal. This is called a hysteresis loss, which has to be minimized for any application where cycling of this magnetic field is involved. Transformer is a case with only the frequency is only 50 hertz, nothing. Ferrites are used for microwaves and other things where the frequencies are much larger, gigahertz and other things, where you can assume what kind of an energy loss will be there if the hysteresis losses are very much. So this hysteresis area must be very small in such cases. So one can define soft and hard magnetic materials depending on the values of this one. When the hysteresis losses are, I mean the loop is very big, then you call magnetically hard materials, otherwise soft materials. I think all these things are self-explanatory. Okay. This is the last part. So what happens is, I will only qualitatively mention. So what happens is, you started with a material which actually is a ferromagnetic particle. As I told you, it always prefers to be in multi-domain system than in the single domain case. But when you start reducing the size, when the size is reduced, what is going to happen is, at certain time, one can show that the size has come to a value where it is not in a position to support two domains, two domain, that means a domain wall. Because the domain walls may be taking more energy, so that it is not an energetically an advisable situation for having two domains with the help of a domain wall. So this, once this state is arrived, the system prefers to be in a single domain status than having a multi-domain situation. The calculations are shown here, please work it out. If you have any doubt, you can actually ask me because we are running out of time. So when the size of the particle is generally less, the tendency for this multi-domain formation is reducing, and the system has a tendency to be a single domain, that is what is shown in this calculation. So this shows you that one actually gets, so when the particle size is reduced in that manner, first it to get into what is known as a single domain material system, where the whole material, the whole material particle is just one domain. Now if you reduce further, this is quite unstable against thermal energy, and anything, any magnetic moment which is unstable against thermal energy is a paramagnet. That is a characteristic of a paramagnet. But remember, now this is not a one single ionic magnetic moment or atomic magnetic moment. This is a particle like a nanoparticle, and this is forced to behave like a paramagnet. But originally it belongs to a ferromagnetic family, only because the size has been reduced, it has become like this. So this is called a super paramagnet. A super paramagnet is slightly below the size of a single domain particle, and the interesting point is this is very important. So what is expected is the coercivity, which is a very important parameter of hysteresis that I mentioned. As you start with a ferromagnetic system where you have this multi domains, as you reduce the size, what you see is that coercivity increases. And when it reaches a so called single domain situation, you have only one domain, there are no the domain walls are regions where you have all kinds of magnetization directions which are not good as far as this anisotropy is concerned, the coercivity is concerned. So the coercivity increases, reaches a maximum at this region. If you reduce the size further, the system enters the so called super paramagnetic region. Anything that is paramagnetic, generally no hysteresis is there, and slowly the hysteresis related properties will come down, and that is what you are showing here. So hysteresis, the coercivity increases, reaches a maximum at the single domain situation, and then decreases and becomes zero in the completely super paramagnetic regime. This is the end of this talk. I think we will take a couple of questions.
So my question is, how the internal field can be calculated in paramagnetic material? You have mentioned in one of the slides.
In fact, I will tell how it can be measured in both the cases. The internal field, I will not call it internal field in the case of a paramagnet. I will use the word internal field for a ferromagnet only. For a paramagnet, I will tell the interactions among the magnetic moments. That strength can be determined by the theta value, chi equal to c by t minus theta, the what is known as the paramagnetic Curie temperature, that is called a theta. So once I measure theta, theta is a measure of the interaction strength of these paramagnets. I will reserve the word internal field for ferromagnets, where the interactions are much stronger. It is not the dipole-dipole interaction or anything, it is an exchange interaction, the spin dependent Coulomb interaction that I talked about, much stronger. The measure of that internal field in the case of a ferromagnet is nothing but the Curie temperature. The Curie temperature is more, means the internal field is stronger. If it is low, means the internal field is weak. So the Curie temperature is the best thing to measure the internal field strength of a ferromagnet. For a paramagnet, I do not want to call it as a internal field, but the interaction strength I will call, that is represented by your theta.
So thank you, sir. I have one more question.
Please.
How the domain area, domain wall area will get increased when the applied field is increased?
Yeah, so it is not
a domain. Is there any relation?
Yeah, it is not the domain wall area, actually it is a volume. What happens is when you apply the magnetic field, definitely there are many domains which have different directions, randomly oriented. There will be at least one domain whose intrinsic magnetization direction will be coinciding with the applied field. So because when you have minus mu dot h term minimized, that particular the domain size will increase, so that the energy minimization happens, like the Zeeman term. So to reduce the Zeeman energy minus mu dot h kind of term, the domain which has got exactly same direction of magnetization as the applied field, that will increase the size. When that increases, it has to be at the expense of some other domain. So the unfavorable domain directions will decrease. How does it happen? Remember, the domain and domain wall, everything is made up of ions and their moments. So basically, the domain walls kind of move in such a manner so that this favorable domain size increases at the expense of others. This, remember, this is not a smooth movement, this is a jerky movement, this is an irreversible movement. That is why the jerkiness actually you can see in the form of, if you magnify it, any magnetization plot, there is a very small fine jump that is called the Barkhausen jumps, and the irreversible nature is reflected in the hysteresis loop. So, the way it actually goes is the domain wall movement is quite restricted by various contributions, defects, impurities, externally made things, internal intrinsic things, everything kind of impede the domain wall motion. In certain applications where you need to have large hysteresis areas like permanent magnets, one artificially creates the so-called pinning centers. You create artificially domain wall pinning centers so that you get a broader hysteresis loop. In other extreme, when you are looking for an extremely soft magnetic material, you will try to get a clean system, absolutely no defects, no pinning center. It is ideal case, but one can only minimize it.
Sir, a material can be easily magnetized through EC direction, 100 plane.
Right. In the case of
and
FE only.
It is difficult to be magnetized along hard direction.
Yeah.
So, on which basis we select this direction?
Yeah.
Is direction changes with respect to material or not?
It is, we can choose, it is the nature. It is determined by the material, it changes from material to material. That is why in the example that I showed you is exactly for FE. If I take nickel exactly ulta, it's 100 is hard and 111 is easy. What is determining this is, to some extent it is determined by the crystal structure. It is determined by the ionic presence, what is the symmetry of the ions, the crystal field that is acting on it. This will determine what kind of a direction is favorable, what is not favorable. It is quite dependent on the crystal structure. For that matter, since this question is very important, let me add to that. If you are taking cubic crystals, Fe and nickel are cubic systems, the difference between 100 or 111, even though I showed an exaggerated figure, the difference actually is small. Compared to a case when you have a hexagonal system trying to magnetize in the AB plane versus the C plane, the difference is huge. Why? Because this is a uniaxial system, the crystal structure itself is anisotropic. Cubic case is a symmetric case, more or less symmetric, right? Cubic is more or less symmetric. So, you cannot expect too much of an anisotropy in a cubic system, which is naturally a symmetric case. Whereas, when you have an anisotropic crystal structure, the magnetic anisotropy is also going to be very large. Because of this reason, any magnet that you are seeing, any bar magnet that you are seeing is always made of a material which is having a uniaxial crystal structure. It is never made up of a cubic system. It is not possible because it will not be stable, because your hysteresis area will be smaller, even though I told the exaggerated figure, but the difference will be small in the case of a cubic system. So, the difference between EC and hard axis is dependent very much on the crystal structure.
Sir, I have doubt that you talked about this electron-electron interaction, sir.
Yeah.
Whether this electron-electron interaction plays a vital role in vicinal coupling?
Electron-electron interaction?
Plays a vital role in vicinal coupling? Or vicinal coupling has this electron-electron interaction?
No. I am looking at only the electrostatic interaction between the electron and electron. I took the example of hydrogen molecule. I was trying to calculate the Coulomb interaction between these two electronic charges quantum mechanically. If I do classically, it is a simple E square by R12 term. I am doing it using the wave function. I am trying to calculate the expectation value of that one, because in quantum mechanics, I have to calculate the expectation value. Why? Because that is nothing but a perturbation change. That expectation value of this term will give me the corresponding energy shift. So, I was simply calculating the expectation value in quantum mechanics for this particular term, the Coulomb term. It is a very simple Coulomb term.
Sir, in NMR studies,
yeah,
we are mainly considering the spin-spin coupling, sir.
Yeah, NMR is, that is why, yeah, I just talked about magnetic resonance in the earlier lecture. Yeah, tell me.
Sir, but in this spin-spin coupling, we talk about geminal and both vicinal also.
Let me tell you.
Whether this electron interaction changes the value, chemical shift value?
Of course, it will change. It will change. That is different topic altogether. But in the case of you are talking about NMR line shift, right? It is definitely going to change depending on the, yeah. So because what happens is there you are talking about a hyperfine coupling. You are going to talk about the nuclear versus electron coupling. The hyperfine coupling, definitely it is going to change. Yes.
Sir, that's what there is. This electron-electron plays a role in both geminal and vicinal.
Yes, yes, yes.
That's
yes,
my question.
Yes, but in my case, yeah, I am only interested in the usual electrostatic term.
Okay, sir. Thank you so
but
much.
But it's an indirectly, it is related to the spin-spin interaction.
Yeah, of course, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Is there any relation between cell energy and magnetostatic energy when orbital radii will increase?
What the difference between magnetostatic energy and
relation between cell energy and magnetostatic energy when radii will be increased of
what,
atom?
What is cell energy?
Subcell, sir. Cell and subcell energy.
Okay, shell and okay. No. Shell is purely an atomic property. No. So definitely not. We are actually not talking about that. So we are talking about the magnetostatic energy is basically a solid property. Magnetostatic energy is you are talking about when it is magnetized, all the atoms. So we don't really take the atomic picture into account there. You are having a net magnetization, the bulk magnetization. What is the energy associated with that? Just because it is magnetized in a particular direction, and is there any unstable part associated with that? Is there any energy that has increased because of the process of magnetization, which actually is true here? That is what we are calculating. There is no atomic interpretation for that. No.
Sir, one more question.
Yeah.
How to find the electron density when subcell size will increase? Suppose SPDFC subcell is given.
Yeah.
So how to find the electron density or probability of an electron density?
You have to use some kind of X-ray kind of spectroscopy you have to use. Not an imaging you can do, but it's I think is very difficult. Indirectly you can use some kind of a spectroscopic technique so that you can actually probe the electron density. These days of course lot of imaging techniques are also available. So one has to do that. But then the problem is it cannot be a very depth information that you can get. It will be more of a, you can do even X-ray to some extent can give you indirectly this information of electron densities associated with even bulk systems. One can do that. So basically what you have to do is you have to take X-ray diffraction pattern and you have to do a proper refinement. Once you can do a refinement, the standard refinement is what is known as a Rietveld refinement. If you are an expert in that one, you can get the information of actual electron density map. So you can get that. But you cannot tell SPD and all using that one. For that, what you have to do is you have to do a spectroscopy in the sense that you can use X-ray spectroscopy, not a diffraction technique. You have to use an X-ray spectroscopy or things like that. So you can actually find out the binding energies and get some information about that. Otherwise, telling that this is S electron density, this is P electron density, I doubt very much.
Sir, I want to make the analog between grain and domain, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
In grains, there are defects like dislocations, point defects like that.
Yeah.
Is there anything in domains also dislocation defects like that?
No,
is there?
No. Grain is a crystallographic defect, right? So you talked about long range periodicity in the morning. So the defects associated with that gives rise to the polycrystalline, the long range it is not possible, but in the local dimensions it is possible, that gives rise to the polycrystalline sample. So polycrystalline has many crystallites, that is called a grain, and they are separated by grain boundaries. The domain is purely a magnetic concept. There is, to my knowledge, there is nothing like a defect in that sense. The domain wall is the only thing which actually can be treated as a defect, in the sense that within the domain, the magnetization is completely spontaneously magnetized, in the same direction. The domain, any domain is spontaneously magnetized, but the domain wall regions are bad as far as this is concerned, because they, again remember, domain walls has a finite width, they have an associated energy and so on, but that is the only thing that actually can create some problem. For example, as I told you, when you reduce the particle size, as you are seeing, the coercivity is increasing. Why? The role of these domain walls is decreasing. That is the domain wall region is the one where you have all kinds of directions and so on. So, which is actually a reverse thing, magnetization not in a particular direction. That is why it is going against the anisotropy idea. So, it is becoming kind of isotropic. So, that is why once you are getting rid of these domain walls, slowly you are improving the coercivity. That is why it increases. It reaches at maximum at the single domain condition. There you have only one domain, there is no domain wall, you have reached the maximum coercivity that is possible. Then of course, it comes down because it is entering into a paramagnetic kind of a region. So, as far as this question is concerned, only problem is the domain walls, nothing else. But domain wall motion when it happens, they get impeded, they get pinned by the crystallographic defects like the dislocations and other things that you are telling.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Yeah. Sir, you explained well about that super paramagnetism.
Yeah.
What are the experiments as are required to conduct super paramagnetism?
To prove super paramagnetism?
Yes, sir. What are the experiments are required to confirm that super paramagnetism?
Yeah, it's actually a little difficult to confirm. To confirm that is not very easy. One thing is, of course, you have to use various techniques to do that. One is, you can actually take an MH plot, the hysteresis plot. You should not get any hysteresis, that is number one. That does not again prove that it is this one. What one can do is that you can actually find out the effective magnetic moment. Effective magnetic moment typically will be very large because this is a particle, not an atom. It is expected to, it can be something like 100 Bohr magneton, 200 Bohr magneton. This is one possibility. You can actually do certain AC techniques. For example, an AC magnetic susceptibility can be done. AC magnetic susceptibility, dynamic susceptibility, not the DC. There again, it is not a confirmatory test. You can get some information. What you can do is that you know something about the system that you are working. Then you have to combine all these results together. You will be able to make a meaningful, guess. That's all I will tell. So, otherwise tell that it is exactly super paramagnetic, it is not a very simple thing. Because there are other interactions which will have more or less same kind of features, to rule them out is not very easy.
Sir, the domain region size are in the microscopy scale.
Yeah.
Let us 10 power minus 4 to 10 power minus 6.
Yeah.
How did we confirm, sir, that?
Domains, the size of the domains.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, size of the domains can be measured, various techniques are available. There is a Kerr microscopy is available, which of course is not very simple. It is an optical technique because the polarization gets shifted by the magnetic field direction. So, that is there. High resolution TEM is also able to show this one. There is an attachment needed. The simplest thing that people talk about is what is known as a bitter pattern, where you do is, what you take is you take a clean ferromagnetic surface. You pour a ferrofluid on that, the force that is acting on this ferrofluid particles is different in the domain region and in the domain wall region. So, this actually traces out the domains and from there you can get a guess of this domain size.
Sir, but in the case of the super paramagnetism, you explained well. What about the surface effect, sir? You explained well about the crystal field effect and everything you said. What about that surface effect?
Surface effect is there in the case of nanoparticle, that is an issue. Because what happens is there is an abrupt discontinuity there. That's why if you remember, I have shown you a parallel direction of a plane and a perpendicular direction of plane. If the for example, there is a sudden jump from material medium to the air. So, there can be problems there. There can be roughness and all other contributions at the surface, which are actually can kind of lock these magnetic moments. So, that is why in certain cases, in spite of the fact that the demagnetization contribution demands that the plane of EC magnetization should be, the EC magnetization direction should be the plane, but in some cases due to the other contribution, the surface contribution that you are talking about, it is possible to get a perpendicular thing. But the problem is, it is not much of a physics that is known on that. How the surface actually contributes is not very clear. The surface effects have become important only now when the nano thing came. Till then, nobody really worried too much about it. So, if you ask me, I cannot give an explanation on the basis of crystal field theory on this one, because it is not known very clearly. Surface effects are known to show some effects, but what is a physical basis for that is not very clear at the moment.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful answer, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, my question is, we start from the ferromagnetic materials and go to paramagnetisms. You explained that there are two ways, one by increasing the temperature and second by decreasing the dimension of the domains.
Yeah.
In one case, we reach at paramagnetism, in second case, we reach at super paramagnetism.
Yeah.
Now, how the property will change is, this paramagnetism and super paramagnetism are different? If they are different, so what are the physical property that changes in this transition? Second question is there is interaction between spin and electrostatic field?
No, zero. That is zero. That is straight away zero. The spin is influenced only by magnetic field. That is, let me answer that question first. So, spin is influenced only by the magnetic field. Electrostatic field has no role in that one. Coming to the other question, there is a small difference. I talked about the ferromagnetism to paramagnetic transition, that is a magnetic transition, is temperature induced. Okay, so there the temperature changes, there is a thermodynamical, it changes from one phase to the other, ferromagnetic phase to the paramagnetic phase, that is right. So that is because the order is reducing, it actually goes from the high ordered phase to a low ordered phase. The super paramagnetism is different. It's not a phase transition in that sense. It is, you are starting with the material, you are playing with the material, you are reducing the size. That is your job, not the nature's job. It is, you are reducing the size of the particle, and because of the domain structure and the domain wall structure, below a point, it is not able to contain even one domain wall, which means that it cannot support domains. In that region, it has to take only single domain, and further if you reduce, the energy, the magnetic energy becomes comparable, because the size of the particle has become so small, that magnetic energy becomes comparable to thermal energy. Whenever you have magnetic energy becoming comparable to thermal energy, that is precisely paramagnetism. The random alignment of magnetic moments is paramagnetism. So we tell, even though its birth was in a ferromagnetic family, you have reduced the size, that is our job. And you have reduced it, you have killed some interactions, you have made it smaller and smaller. Now you have reduced the magnetic part to such a low value so that the thermal energy is able to compete with it, and hence you are telling that you have to treat it, definitely this is not a ferromagnetic particle now, you have to call it as a paramagnetic particle. But the problem is, it is not a usual paramagnetism that we know of. This one important difference is the magnetic moment is much larger. As I mentioned to the earlier question, it can be 200, 300 Bohr magnetons, whereas atomic moments are maybe maximum 5, 6 Bohr magnetons. So, this is what we are making artificially. Of course, when it happens, the system has to energetically be stable and the nature is doing that job. But this is not a phase transition like the ferromagnetic paramagnetic phase transition that we talked about. So, they can't compare.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Why Cooper pass are called bosons, sir? Can you explain me?
Yeah. What is the spin of an electron? It is half. What is the spin of a Cooper pair? It is 1, 1. When you add half and half, it can be 1 or 0. Yeah, 1 or 0, right. So, 1 or 0 is an integer spin. Integer spin must be a boson. Integer spin must be a boson as per the spin statistics theorem.
Sir, I have one more question. Why does a permanent magnet have an advantage over an electromagnet?
A very relevant question. The advantages are like this. Electromagnet is very heavy compared to a permanent magnet of the same field. You need to have a cooling system, you need to have a current, power depends on the power. If the power is not there, rural places you cannot have an electromagnet in India today. Whereas a permanent magnet, as the name suggests, it is permanent. But to get the size, you need a small pieces, you have to have a particular arrangement, you have to get a meaningful field and other things. You need to work out the design in such a manner so that the region where you require the field, you get the required field. It's not very easy. But these days the problem is you can get the magnets, but the magnet cost is also going up. The main difference, of course, I will tell is the size, because electromagnet is huge. it's not something which you cannot transport. I mean, going from one place to other, it's not easy. I will not really compare that way. I will tell you, it depends on the application. For example, to conduct an experiment in a lab, I will definitely prefer an electromagnet if the power situation is all right.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.